across and across that way. And that Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, he started a movement, you could call it a sect or a movement within Islam, that is called the Ahmadiyya Muslim Movement. And I showed about Aziz Kashmiri. Aziz Kashmiri is one of the leaders of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Movement. There are Ahmadiyya Muslims here in the United States, many thousands of them. There are several million Ahmadiyya Muslims in that region of northern Pakistan, northwestern India, and in other parts of the world also. That one of the interesting things I've spoken several times at Ahmadiyya Muslim conferences. By the way, I don't know if I mentioned, but Billy Meyer, if I'm not mistaken, that Askit, who was Billy's teacher for 11 years, Askit at one point asked Billy to join various different religions, the Jewish religion, other religions, and so on. And one of the religions that Billy joined for a while was the Ahmadiyya Muslim religion. And that Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, he, at one point in the 1890s, early 1900s, he made a prophecy. He said that 100 years from now, the latter part of the 20th century, there'll be young people from the West, from America and Europe, who will come to India, and they'll travel around in India, and will find information that proves that Jesus lived in India, and they will write books about it and give talks about it. And that at one of those Ahmadiyya conferences, with a lot of people there, that one of the elders stood up and he told about that prophecy, and he pointed at me and he said, "Here is the fulfillment of prophecy." And I was like, "Whoa, okay." And this is Holger Kersten's book. I may not pronounce the German names the right way, but Holger Kersten wrote, "Jesus Lived in India, His Unknown Life Before and After the Crucifixion." And I certainly admit it was a hard pill for me to swallow about the survival of the crucifixion. And, oh, yes, I'll show you again. Holger Kersten, K-E-R-S-T-E-N, Holger Kersten. Right, this one is in English. It's translated into English, and it's a book that's in print, and you can find that either at a local bookstore or they can order it for you. It's in print. Holger Kersten lives at, I believe, Freiburg in Germany, and teaches, I think, at a theology school. But Holger Kersten is, we'll find some more about his research. Let me show you about a website here. Let's see if I'm, there we go. The Tomb of Jesus Christ. This is the photo taken by Holger Kersten, that same photo. And the website is very simple, www.tombofjesus.com. And this has research and all this information and so on, related information that I'm in the vendors area, and Jim Deerdorf is back there, Wendell's there, Mike Whelan, and you know about Mike's book, I'll hold it up, Wendell held it up earlier, but anyway, I'm over there all week, and if you would like to follow up on any of this information, I'll give you, be happy to give you free information, and also I'll be happy to give you a business card. At the bottom of my card, I've got Jim Deerdorf's website, and Jim Deerdorf's website is a marvelous website that has extensive information about the Talmud of Emmanuel, and it also has dozens and dozens of connecting links to other UFO sites, UFO-related sites. It's a wonderful website, and he updates it frequently also. Let me just show you that we're just kind of... See. Oh, yeah, here we go. This is Dr. Fida Hasnain, who lives there in Srinagar. And Dr. Fida Hasnain is one of the main researchers also about Jesus in India. He wrote A Search for the Historical Jesus, written in 1994. And the reason that I'm showing this right now, we'll go to the next one. I want to show you something about survival of a crucifixion. That this is interesting. This is an account by Flavius Josephus, a famous historian. And this is kind of neat. I was sent by Titus Caesar with Cerealis and 1,000 riders to a certain town by the name of Thessoa to find out whether a camp could be set up at this place. On my return, I saw many prisoners who had been crucified and recognized three of them as my former companions. I was inwardly very sad about this and went with tears in my eyes to Titus, that was the Roman governor, and told him about them. He at once gave the order that they should be taken down and given the best treatment so they could get better. However, two of them died while being attended to by the doctor. The third recovered. In other words, we'll see some more things about crucifixions and people surviving crucifixions, especially if their legs are not broken. And we go down to the next part here. This is about Jesus. He eventually married a woman named Marianne, who bore him children. And we'll jump on down to the next part. Oh, this. He died at about the age of 110 to some people believe maybe 120 years. The figure that I've heard the most is right in the range of 110 to 115 years, maybe 112 years old, something right in that range. And the Talmud of Emmanuel relates how that following the crucifixion and following his recovery, after he had recovered for 2 years in Damascus, that the life force was more powerful than ever. He was stronger and more vigorous, more powerful than ever, and the spiritual power was increased also. And that there was a great deal more travel, and we'll talk about that later, a great deal more travel that he did, not just to India, but very likely that he visited some other places such as Japan, various places in Europe, such as England, and that also America. We'll see some interesting things here in a little bit. Let me show you just quickly about this. The route that going over to India, it may well have been a route like this through Afghanistan, across like this, down here, spending some time with the Jain religion, the Jain people over here, across this way to Jagannath, eastern India, state of Orissa, and then down to Madras, and then up here this way, Rajagriha, over to Benares, now called Varanasi. There's a Hindu healing school here where he spent time. And there's an interesting story about eye surgery. There are accounts that even 2,000 years ago they did eye surgeries here with obsidian blades, and that Jesus may have studied with them. They had something to deaden the eyes and to cut out cataracts with obsidian blades. And then up here, Kapilavastu, birthplace of the Buddha, that Jesus was there. He was there at Lhasa, and he may have met and studied with a great sage named Mingsti or Mencius, and then later traveled by Mount Kailas, a sacred mountain in western Tibet, up here at the Himaskompa Monastery in Leh, over here to Srinagar, and then back returning through southern Afghanistan, southern Iran, and across this way and back, and that he may well have been in his early 20s, maybe around 23, 24 years old, when he returned back to Jerusalem. And that this is a wonderful book by Janet Bach, The Jesus Mystery of Lost Years and Unknown Travels. This is a wonderful book, and Janet Bach is a devotee of Sai Baba. And we'll talk more. Incidentally, Sai Baba, for those of you who know him, Sai Baba confirmed through his own spiritual means, his own spiritual insight, Sai Baba has confirmed that Jesus did live in India, and that is true. And Paramahansa Yogananda, for those of you who know who he was, that Paramahansa Yogananda also confirmed that Jesus lived in India. This is the inside of the Jagannath Temple there in eastern India, where young Jesus spent about 6 years. This is Sai Baba, and as I mentioned, Sai Baba confirmed that Jesus lived in India. I'm not a devotee myself of Sai Baba, but I've only heard good things about him. And let's see. This is Celestial Teachings. This is just a black and white Xerox that a radio interviewer borrowed my copy and lost it. But anyway, it's a wonderful book. It's by Jim Deardorff. And Soul Samples by Leo Sprinkle. Many of you know Leo. Leo's a wonderful individual. And here's a photo of Leo. And incidentally, his office phone number, mailing address, it's in the back of my book in the resources section. Leo wrote the foreword for my book. And also that if you want, that Leo, if you ask him to, he can do a higher self reading. He can, like Edgar Cayce, he can go into a self trance, and speaking from the higher self, he can give you a reading. He can do that over the telephone without ever having met him, if you like. And the readings are I have found very accurate and very helpful, and they step on toes too. He doesn't mince any words. This is a photo of that this here's Barbara Lamb, here's Barbara, here's Helen Billings, George Cruz, and myself, and this is